Christ Community Church, located at 25th and Thomas Avenue in Portsmouth, Ohio.
See, last time that I was here, I closed with a little, it was meant as a joke, I promise, that I was going to be judged on how well you guys tithed on the way out, and you guys must have been feeling stingy or something, because it's been a year since he's invited me to come back up on this stage and preach again, so we got to work on that a little bit. But no, the title of my—I'm totally kidding. I'm totally kidding. If you're new here, just—I promise, I'm joking. But if you're new here, first, let me just say we're really glad you're here, and we're honored that you're here with us. And I promise you, if you have kids, especially, introduce them to me. I'd love to meet them. Love to hang out with them a little bit. But the title of my sermon today is going to be "Jesus Led a Youth Group," and I promise you that we will get into that. We absolutely will get into that. But before we do, I want to talk a little bit about my youth group, about my kiddos. Go ahead and throw that first image up, if you would, please. The one of us at Summer in the Sun, the full group of us. Now, these are our students at Summer in the Sun, and they're squinting because we were looking directly into the sun. It was very, very bright that day. But I have a question, and I just want you to think about it. Don't say it out loud. Is this the church of the future? Is that the church of the future? Or is that the church? Is that the church now? Is that the church of the future, or is that the church? The reason I didn't want you to answer is because the answer is yes. That is the church of the future, 100%, but it doesn't stop there. That is also the church of right now. And I'm going to prove it to you. Because we're going to look at what the church was supposed to do. See, the early church has kind of documented what they took seriously. What they took seriously is documented in Acts 2:42. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. To the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Go ahead and throw that next slide up. These are our students in the upper room on a Sunday morning this summer. This is after one of my lessons, and they were dialed in. And see, whenever we end all of my lessons, we always end with a word of prayer. Always. Now, if Matt's preaching, he wants to get to the restaurants or wants to go watch football or something, so it's like, oh, they're dismissed. Okay, let's pray. If Scott's preaching, I got a little bit more time. This happened to be one of those weekends where he was preaching, and I had a little bit more time, and I wanted to make sure our students had time to reflect. And so what I did is, you can see on the screen there, there's a music video playing in the background. And what these kids are doing is they are praying. They're praying before school starts. And what are they praying for? They're praying that God will use them. They're praying that God will use them to be tools for the kingdom of God and that they can have an impact on the schools and where they are. Not only that, they're praying for their teachers. They're praying that God will be with their teachers and help them throughout the year. They're praying for their school as a whole. They're interceding for their friends. You can't tell me that's just the church of the future. That's the church now. But let's not stop there. Let's look a little bit further. What else are they doing? Well, a few years back, we used to go to work camp all the time. Right, we went to work camp when I was in junior high and high school, and I worked on staff with Reach Work Camps for 2 years after high school, two of the best summers of my life. I loved it, but then we switched. And I've had some people ask, why did you switch? Why did you stop going to work camp? It's pretty simple. My job as a youth pastor is to make sure that your students, my students, these kids here at Christ Community Church, when they leave here and go on, that they have a strong relationship with Jesus Christ. And that they can defend that relationship, because it's tough being a young person right now. It is tough. They're getting pulled in all different directions. And there's stuff all over the media, all in the news and on TV and everywhere in their friend groups saying that, well, what we believe isn't even real. And then it gets them thinking. So it's tough being a young kid right now. And my job is to make sure that they have that strong relationship with Jesus Christ. At Reach Work Camps, they do a great, great ministry there. Mike Jones and his staff, I love all of them. They do a phenomenal job. And the work that they put in is unreal. And you've seen the pictures of what our students do when they're at work camp and the fruits of their labor and the people that they get to bless. But one thing that I felt like our students weren't getting out of it is they weren't taking their devotional time, or they weren't really getting an impact from their devotional time. See, we have a morning and an evening program at work camp, and I didn't feel like our students were really getting enough out of it. Because any atheist can build a wheelchair ramp or fix a roof, paint a wall. But they can't get into the kingdom of God, and that's what I'm truly worried about. So, what do? We switch to summer and the sun. Now, at work camp, our kids had a blast. And they did amazing, amazing work. And I'll always be proud of them for that. And we may go back to work camp someday. I'm not opposed to that. But they built wheelchair ramps. They repaired roofs. They did drywall repair. They painted. And they made impacts on their neighbors while they were working there. And going forward, now we go to, that's in the summer. In the fall, we go to fall retreat. We have a really good time there, too. We play games. We eat like kings. And it is, I promise you, it's real good food. And we make it ourselves. First night, we have calzones. It's unreal. It's fantastic. So, we have a great time at fall retreat. But the time that they take really serious is our devotional time. Then we go to Summer in the Sun. And we're going to watch that video again. Our Summer in the Sun video. At the end of my sermon, I'm going to show you that again so that you can see it from a different perspective. Because at Summer in the Sun, we have a great time. We play Gaga Ball. If you don't know what that is, come talk to me. Our youth will definitely explain what Gaga Ball is. We eat. I mean, we eat okay. We have, it's the college food. We survive. But we have a good time. We play tons of games. We hang out in the dorms and get to know each other a little bit better. But there's more to it than that. See, at work camp, one of the coolest things that I ever got to witness was our youth group become a family. My first year as a youth minister, I remember there was always a serious night at work camp, and we'd have some students crying or really, really thinking about some tough stuff going on in their life, and I start bouncing around to student to student to student. It's like, okay, I got to help here, I got to help here, I got to help here. The last time we went to work camp on that serious night, and it's always Thursday, I remember I just sat in a chair and sat back and watched. And all of a sudden, I see my leaders from the youth group who had left the gym. They're back in the gym, and they're going to our other students, putting their arm around them, praying for them, opening up their Bible, looking at Scripture. Okay, what does Scripture say? How can we get into this? How can I help you? How can I pray for you? This isn't just the church of the future. This is the church, capital T, capital C, right now. Then we go to fall retreat. I told you, we play a bunch of games. The time they take more serious than anything else is our devotional time. We go downstairs and we open up God's Word, and they're dialed in. They're asking questions because they want to know how to apply the Scripture to their life, how to make it real. And they're 100% in. And it is so cool because then I see our students, I'll even sit back a little bit, questions are starting to get asked, and other students are answering. It's so cool to me. They're dialed in. They're becoming that family. They're reaching out and helping one another. And then summer in the sun. We play the games, we have fun. Every single day at Summer in the Sun, our students have to go to 2 breakout sessions. Every day. Or I'm sorry. It's 2 breakout sessions, 2 different sessions throughout the week that are broken up throughout the week. They go to a breakout session every single day while we're at Summer in the Sun, and they get 2 different lessons poured into them. One of them was how to share your faith. And we had a ton of students go to that. How to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with your friends, because that can be awkward, but they don't care about the awkward feeling they get. They want to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Another one is how to help someone who's dealing with thoughts of suicide. This is serious stuff. This isn't kid stuff. This is church stuff, and our kids are right in the middle of it. And then we come back. We've talked about, you know, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Our kids are 100% in for the teaching of Jesus Christ. To fellowship, they're absolutely all about fellowship. They love hanging out with everybody, meeting new friends from all across the country when we're at work camp, Summer in the Sun, and getting that family dynamic within our own youth group. It's a really, really cool thing to see. And if you don't believe me, talk to Jenny again about her son, who is a quiet kid, and ask him about his friends that he now has in the youth group. Because he wasn't quiet at Summer in the Sun, I promise you that. So we've got apostles teaching, we've got fellowship, the breaking of bread every week up in the upper room. We do our own version of breaking bread. Like we do communion here, and that's awesome. Upstairs, we've got our own snack bar, we've got candy galore, we've got popcorn, we've got our own mini fridge full of water and pop or soda if you're not from around here. That's just weird. I'm sorry. But it's all right. But we've got it all. We break our bread upstairs. And then to baptism. Baptizing in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and to prayer. We're going to get into the baptism part in a little bit too, but remember that, because summer in the sun, we came back, we had 5 new baptisms that weekend. And to prayer, you saw it. Our kids are praying. They're dialed in. What else are they doing? Well, we came back, we baptized 5 people. 2 of them, Caleb and Braden Miller, they were up here singing. They're leading you in worship. And they started like that very next weekend. They got baptized like, let's do this. Let's lead some people. These kids are the church. Brady Keaton, he didn't know I was going to give him a shout out. He's the one hiding back in the drum cage today. He was on the box drum, the cajon. He was killing it on the drums because he wants to lead people in worship. Not only that, he didn't know I was going to talk about this. Brady has taken it upon himself to start a teen apologetics page on Instagram. Apologetics means you can defend your faith. He's giving tools to other teens that he may never even meet, but that follow his page, so that he can make sure that when they go off to college, when they go out into the real world, they know that Jesus is the only way. They know the gospel of Jesus is 100% true. It's 100% accurate. These kids are living it. Yes, they're the church of our future, but they're the church of now. So what did Jesus command? What did Jesus command us to do? Well, if we look in Matthew 28, verses 16 through 19, it all boils down to the Great Commission. Verse 19, the whole story is 16 through 19, but if you look at verse 19, it comes with the command from Jesus himself, and it simply says, go to verse 19. Verse 19 says, therefore, go. Make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We're making disciples, and we're baptizing our kids. We had 5 of them coming back from summer in the sun. We've baptized a couple since then. We've baptized a couple kids since then because they believe this stuff. They love this stuff, and they're 100% bought in. Let's keep on going. Now, if you look at Jesus' plan for the church as a whole, it kind of resembles a youth ministry plan. And I'm going to talk about that. So if we start with John 21, verses 15 through 19, we've got this one upstairs, I know. So Jesus is talking to Peter here. And it says, when they had finished eating, I want you to listen to the language. Listen to the actual words that are being used. Because we're used to hearing this, if you love me, feed my sheep, feed my sheep, feed my sheep, right? It's not really what's said here. In the Greek, it's very, very specific what it says. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my lambs. He's talking about the youth. Feed my lambs. Present the gospel to these lambs, to the youth, because why? They can change the culture. Let's keep going. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And he answered, yes, Lord. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, take care of my sheep. Start with the lambs. Now you're going to take care of my sheep. And then the third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. Now he uses different forms of the word love in that. But I'm focusing on just the sheep right now. He starts with feed my lambs, present the gospel to my lambs, to the youth. Then take care of the older ones, take care of my sheep, and now feed my sheep. Present the gospel to the older ones too. Jesus is focused on the youth of his generation, and because he knows that it is important. He knows what a child is like. Let me ask you a question. Do you have to change a child's mind about God? No, they say, hey, where did this world come from? Say, well, God made it. Okay, good. God made the world. They're in. They don't go, well, did he really make the world because Big Bang Theory and blah, 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 blah. No, they're bought in. And if you don't believe me, go talk to Carter Wolf. Tell her God didn't make the world and be ready for a 30-minute conversation of her telling you that he absolutely did. She's going to make sure you believe it when you walk out of here. You don't have to change a kid's mind, and that's why Jesus loves children. He knows the importance of children and youth. Yes, Jesus figured it out. Jesus had everything figured out because he's Jesus. That's obvious. But cultures figured this out too. Anybody ever heard of McDonald's? Anybody out there? Yeah? You know McDonald's for a while, right? The Golden Arches, delicious fries, you know the works. Do your kids know about McDonald's? Well, of course they do. Why? Because they're marketed to. McDonald's is going to spend over $1 billion of direct marketing this year. And guess what? All your kids, they know about McDonald's. Why? Because they get their own Happy Meal. They get a toy. It's awesome. I mean, I like McDonald's. It's obvious. Next, what about Disney? Disney caters to kids, right? They're going to spend over $2 billion of direct marketing to kids. And why? Why are they going to spend that much money? Why is McDonald's going to spend it? Because they know you're going to ask your kids after church today, hey, where do you want to go eat? McDonald's. They want to go to McDonald's. And if they say McDonald's, you're going to McDonald's because you don't want to deal with the fit. I get it. I've seen those fits. I see them before they even head out to the parking lot sometimes. And parents, or Disney knows that they can cater to the kids because parents will take their kids to Disney. By the way, if you're going to Disney anytime soon, Rachel's been nagging me ever since we've been together. We've been married over 5 years now. We haven't gone a month probably without her bringing up, hey, you know, Disney's having a discount this month. So if you want to go to Disney and you need a babysitter, Rachel is willing to go. You don't even have to pay her. That'll be payment enough, just taking her with you. You think I'm kidding? Okay. let's look at another one. There has been an industry that has completely taken over just the caffeine industry in our nation. You want to know what that logo is? What is it? Starbucks, right. I just point to an image like, hey, Starbucks, delicious coffee. I like Starbucks. It's a little overpriced, but hey, I'll pay for it because I like Starbucks. In 2005, Starbucks had just over 7,000 stores nationwide. That's really not a whole lot, but they've drastically grown. Since 2005, in 2018, they had over 14,000 stores nationwide. And who do they market to? Who do they market to? They don't market to the older generation. Now, older generation, absolutely, they love Starbucks too. They love coffee, so they'll go in there. But for the most part, if you go into Starbucks, who are you going to see working on a MacBook over in a corner drinking their coffee? Who are you going to see at Starbucks? For the most part, the age group you're going to see is probably somewhere between 16 to 40. Because Starbucks has completely saturated our entire country, and now the whole world really, with their caffeine, because everyone knows what Starbucks is, and they market directly to the millennial age, like the Gen X age, that whole age group there, because they know that culture or that age group can change the culture. Now here's the sad part about it. This cup right here represents the 14,000 Starbucks stores nationwide. These beautiful cups with the CCC logo that can be found at our new visitor table. If you're new here, make sure you stop by and get one of these. We'd love to give it to you. But what these represent are the 300,000 Protestant churches in our country that have not done a good enough job spreading or saturating our culture with Jesus Christ. This has done a better job reaching our entire culture than that has for Jesus Christ. That's for caffeine. That's for salvation. Now, I'm not saying it's a bad thing if you go to Starbucks. Enjoy your coffee. That's fine. But we, as a body of believers, need to do a better job of making sure that the people around us know about Jesus Christ. And it can start with our youth. Don't look down on them just because they're young. You might look at them and say, well, you can do that. Maybe when you're older, you'll understand that. This is the church of now. I've shown you stuff. They're praying for each other. They're interceding for their friends. They're baptizing. And you'll see a video now of, it's not just me baptizing. It's our students baptizing other students. Now let's look at somewhere else. Even Adolf Hitler knew the power of youth. Now before I go any further, Adolf Hitler was a psychopath, right? He was insane. He was an evil man, and I'm thank God that his plan did not work. I want to start there. But he came close. And how did he come close? Well, let's look at what his plan was. This is a quote from Adolf Hitler. It says, "I begin with the young. We older ones are used up, but my magnificent youngsters. Are there finer ones anywhere in the world? Look at all these men and boys. What material? With you and I, we can make a new world." Now, he was using that for evil, and he almost succeeded. He completely changed the landscape of Europe, and he wasn't going to stop anytime soon. Luckily, it was cut off. But he was focused on the youth because he knew that the youth could change the culture. And if that psycho can use it for that, think of what the body of believers as a church can do if we can get our youth dialed in to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Think about the change that we can have across our nation and across this entire world if we get our youth believing this stuff. Let's keep on moving. See, we're going to talk about the Jewish education system here in just a second, but if you want to change a culture, where do you start? In the education system, right? See, the difference between Starbucks and the church is Starbucks is worried about making consumers. The church is concerned about making disciples. What's the difference? Consumers are taking in a product. They know the product. They know all about it. They know the facts. People who are really dialed into Starbucks, Rachel, they can give you the newest drink that's out. They can give you the calorie count. They can give you exactly what's in it, everything. They know all about it. They're consumers. It's not enough to be consumers for Jesus. You can't just know this stuff and expect to make a change. Even atheists know the Bible. They'll try to twist scriptures. They'll pull scriptures out from everywhere and try to twist it to make their arguments against it. We got to be disciples. We have to live it. See, it's not enough to know. I told you that if you want to change culture, they try to go to the education system first. See, a while back, our whole culture was becoming sexually driven, and all this other stuff started pouring out. We got all kinds of sexually transmitted diseases now, and people were freaking out, going, okay, what are we going to do? Well, okay, let's start a sex education class in schools. If they know what's going to happen, it'll stop it. Have you looked at our culture today? Did that work? Sex education in junior high and high school. I think I had my sex ed class in my sophomore year of high school. That was 12 years ago. Man, I'm old. But I've just watched culture get more and more and more sexually driven, even though they know all the facts, because we're just consumers. We can't just be consumers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We can't just know the stuff. We have to live it. And that's what I'm hoping our students will do. But they're going to need your help, and we're going to get to that before I'm done here this morning. So let's look at the Jewish school system. See, Jesus, he led youth, and he trained leaders. So here's where you might disagree with me a little bit. I cannot prove this 100%. And if we walk out of here disagreeing, that's okay. I still love you. But I'm going to give you some, what I think is pretty good evidence to prove that the disciples were not middle-aged men. They were probably somewhere between 15 to 20 years old. So let's dive right in. See, if you were growing up in Jewish culture, which all the disciples did, you started off going to a school called Bet Sefer. Bet Sefer was like, the way the Jewish school system was set up was kind of like ours. Like elementary, they've got their primary and their secondary school, and then they've got something even higher than that we'll get to in a second. But they start off with Bet Sefer. In Bet Sefer, they studied just the Torah, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, up until the age of 12 years old. Now, once they hit 12 years old, what can happen? Well, you have one of two options. One, you're not very good at this stuff. We love you, but you're not a good student. So you can go and you can start an apprenticeship. It's kind of like colonial America. Once you start with school, now we're going to put you into the workforce a little bit. And so they'd start this apprenticeship, and they'd be in that till 20, 21, something like that, whatever they made the contract for, and then they would go in until then, and then they'd go out into the workforce, and that was it. But for those who showed a lot of promise in Bet Sefer, once they hit 12 years old, they could go to the next level, their secondary school, which is called Bet Midrash. And in Bet Midrash, they would go for another 2 years. From 13 to 15, they would study some more. And then at 15 years old, they would weed out the best of the best from everyone else. For everyone else, that's when you would start your apprenticeship. That's when you go to a master craftsman. So instead of starting at 12, now you're at 15, and you're starting with this master craftsman so you can learn a tool of the trade so that you can provide for your family and all that fun stuff. But for the ones that were the best of the best, at 15 years old, they would be handpicked by someone called a smicha rabbi. That's a really fancy word for a rabbi. A guy who has done this, he's gone through all the schooling. And once you're handpicked by a smicha rabbi, he would look for his disciples, his 10 to 12, maybe up to 15 disciples to follow him around, to live with him, and to be, one day become their own smicha rabbi and then start looking for their disciples. Do you know how old you were when you became a smicha rabbi? 30. 30 years old. So you'd be with the smicha rabbi for a long period of time, about 15 years, learning under them, becoming a smicha rabbi. You know how old Jesus was when he became, or whenever he started picking his disciples? He was 30. Jesus was 30 years old whenever he started his ministry, whenever he picked his disciples, 30 years old. He was operating within the system of that culture, which is a smart thing to do. It kept people off his back for a little while anyway. But you say that's not enough evidence. Okay, well, let's look at the disciples themselves. Oh, by the way, with the disciples, if they were older than 15 and they'd already been handpicked by a smicha rabbi, Jesus couldn't have taken them. And we know that they weren't in training because they were doing other stuff when Jesus found them, right? So what about Matthew? He was a tax collector, right? He had to have been older. He was a tax collector. Well, if you look at the wording in Scripture, he wasn't the chief tax collector. We know who that was. That was Zacchaeus. He would have been older, about 30, probably somewhere in there. Do you know how they collected taxes back in that time? It was on different routes. So going from town to town, you come to a town, you would have to pay your taxes as you're coming in. Today, we call those toll booths. Matthew was basically a toll booth collector. And that would have been done by someone who was probably around 18, 19 years old. He wasn't the chief tax collector. Now, what about Peter? Peter was actually the only one mentioned in Scripture as being married. It talked about his mother-in-law was healed at one point, so he was married. That's the only one mentioned in Scripture as being married. Why is that important? Well, how old were people when they got married? They were young. Look at Mary and Joseph. It's believed that Joseph was somewhere probably like 16 to 18 years old, somewhere in there. Mary was like 14 to 16. They were kids, and we're cool with that. And that was normal in that culture. But not the disciples, they're middle-aged, right? Because that's how it is in the posters that we see, in the movies that we watch. No, it doesn't change. These guys would have been young. If they were married, things would have been a little bit different. And another thing with Peter is if we look in Matthew 17, go ahead and throw that verse up here. Matthew 17, verse 27. What's happened here is the rabbis come up to Peter, and they're talking to him, trying to get Jesus in trouble already and say, hey, do you pay your temple tax? And your leader, does he pay his temple tax, meaning Jesus? And Peter's like, oh, yeah, we pay. We're good. And then he goes back to find Jesus, and Jesus already knows what happened because he's, well, Jesus. And he's like, Peter, but so that we may not cause offense, go to the lake, throw out your line, take the first fish you catch, open its mouth, and you'll find a 4-drachma coin. Take it and give it to them for my tax and for yours. Who's he paying the taxes for? For mine and for yours. That's just Jesus and Peter. And so that we don't cause offense. Why just Jesus and Peter? If he doesn't want to cause offense, shouldn't it be all of them? Well, to pay your temple tax, you know how old you had to be? 20. So Peter's at least 20. But if he's just paying a temple tax for just Peter and himself, they're a little bit younger. Not only that, let's look at James and John. We always hear good things about James and John, right? Those brothers. Who's following James and John around with Jesus? Well, I've got a Bible verse here. In Matthew 20, verses 20 through 23, said, then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Jesus with her sons and kneeling down, asked a favor of him, meaning she asked a favor of Jesus. What is it you want? he asked. Now, to me, it already sounds like Jesus is annoyed. But who's with him? Mommy. Mommy's with him. We already talked about, yeah, they can be young and be married. I promise you, if mommy's with them, they're not married. Listen, I love my mom very much, but there is a reason that I don't live with my mom anymore. It's because I got married. My mom and my wife, they love each other. But it is very good for us to have separation. Raise your hand if you want to be living with your wife and your mother-in-law at the same time. Great. Wives, who wants to be living with your husband and your mother-in-law? Yeah, we don't. There needs to be that separation. The Bible's very clear that you need that separation. That's healthy. But mommy's with them. They're kids. She's asking that, if you keep on reading there, she's asking that one can sit at Jesus' right and one at his left whenever they get to heaven. And Jesus is like, whoa, you don't know what you're asking. They can't handle what I'm about to go through. And it's not even up to me to decide who's going to sit at my right and who's going to sit at my left. Let's keep on looking. The disciples themselves, as a group, were rebuked. Jesus rebuked his own disciples. Why? Because they were pushing children aside. See, all these parents are bringing their kids up to Jesus to be healed, and they're like, hey, you're bugging Jesus. Back off. And Jesus, it says that he got indignant with the disciples. What does indignant mean? Well, it means that he's annoyed. He's angry with the disciples because they stopped kids from coming to him. He wants those kids. He wants to build those relationships. And in Mark 10:24, he actually refers to the disciples themselves as children. We have Mark 10:24 up there. The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom of God? Or how hard it is, I'm sorry, to enter the kingdom of God. He refers to them as children. Jesus led a youth group. These are guys that are going to make a difference throughout the entire world. See, then Jesus, he was killed on the cross. He was buried. And then 3 days later, he rose again. And then he gives that command to these kids. See, the kids scattered. Whenever Jesus was crucified, for the most part, they took off because they were scared for their own lives. Which, if I'm going to be honest, if I was scared for my own life too, I'd be like, hey, I'm going to go fishing. See ya. I can't blame them, especially if they're this young. And then Jesus goes and finds his disciples, these young kids, and he says, all authority on heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples. He didn't say, hey, when you're older, when you have a better grasp of the scriptures and you can really work through everything, go ahead and go make disciples. No. He's telling them right then, right there, go. So what is the goal of discipleship and following Jesus? One thing I want you to take away from this is that becoming is greater than knowing. And that goes back to this. Being a disciple is more important than just being a consumer. See, consumers take in all the information. They know it, but they're not living it. You have to become like Jesus. You have to become one with God so that you can make an impact. You can make those disciples, and you can make an impact right where you are. And the same goes for our students. And if you don't believe in me, let's look at Scripture. The one word I want you to take from this whole section right here, is abide. You have to abide in Jesus. Become one with Jesus. And there's Scripture in here. Now, all of John 15, you could read all that. I'm not going to ask that you do that, but it's there for you if you want to look it up later. But in John 15, you'll recognize this as, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me, if you abide in me, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. You'll have an impact. But apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, if you do not abide in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers, and such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you want to have an impact on today's society, you have to abide in Jesus. You have to seek out Jesus. You have to first seek out the kingdom of God, right? Seek out God to make an impact today. And that's what our kids are trying to do. Now, one last thing to show that that this is important. The last thing I have on there is be discipled. I don't know if that's correct English or not. I'm assuming not, since I put it in there and got the red line under it from Microsoft Word. I'm assuming that's probably not right. But that's my point I'm making, is you have to put yourself into a position where you can be discipled. There's a guy named Joshua in the Old Testament. He's Moses' right-hand man. And what's really cool is God would talk directly to these guys. They got to see him face to face, and they would have these conversations. And in Exodus 33:11, it's toward the end of this conversation. It says, the Lord would speak to Moses face to face as one speaks to a friend. Then Moses would return to the camp, but his young aide Joshua, son of Nun, did not leave the tent. Joshua was abiding in God. He didn't want to leave the presence of God. He wanted to stay in that tent, and I can't blame him. I would love to stay in a tent and see God face to face. That'd be awesome. But he is so just enamored with abiding in God, he doesn't even want to leave the tent, even though God's done talking. And so what happens a little bit later down the road? Well, if you look in Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 9, throw it up here. It says, now Joshua, son of Nun, was filled with the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him. So the Israelites listened to him and did what the Lord had commanded Moses. Joshua was rewarded for his faithfulness to God, for his desire to know God. He became the leader of the Israelites once Moses had gone on. This is a young guy who God is using to make an impact for his kingdom. Don't look down on these kids just because they're young. They can make an impact today. They can change culture. Look at our culture around us. So much of the stuff around us has been completely driven by the youth of our culture. Has it not? It absolutely has. So please, don't look down on them. Encourage them. Be there for them. Now, before we get to the very end, I told you I was going to show you our Summer in the Sun video again. And I hope that you look at it through a different lens now. Because now you understand what these kids are doing. Don't look at it as just kids having a good time. Now, they should be having a good time. I hope that they are. That's one of the reasons that we go to Summer in the Sun. But it's more than that. They're not just there to have a good time. They're there to make an impact. So when you're watching this video, look at it as the church making an impact. The church reaching out to their other brothers and sisters in Christ to make a difference. Go ahead and roll it.
Swamp, I hear me saying I'm a sinner. How far is east from west? How deep is the deepest sea? How wide are the arms of grace? How empty is the grave? Came down from the mountain, fell down on me. I'll fly from the mountain, don't set me free. Came down from the mountain, fell down on me. I'll fly from the mountain. Wow.
You can't tell me that's just the church of our future. Fellowship might look a little bit differently today than it did back then. But that's a great week for our kids. I hope that you'll help me in empowering this generation of kids. I hope that you'll help me along with that. And I'm actually going to challenge you with that. See, I'm challenging you with a couple things. One, don't look down on our kids, because I promise you, they're ready to accept some challenges here. They're already doing it. And number two is to abide in God. See, you can't reach out to these kids and make a difference in their life if you're not seeking God yourself. So abide in Christ Jesus yourself. Make an effort. And the last thing I want to do is read a quote here from Billy Graham. It says, "We are the Bibles that the world is reading, we are the creeds the world is needing, and we are the sermons the world is heeding." That's true of our students too. And if we want them to become those things, we have to back them up a little bit. So I want to challenge all you parents right now. I want to challenge all you parents to take a step. So you always back up your kids with sports. You're at the football games, the basketball games, soccer games, everything, like you should be. You're at the choir performances, like you should be. And you're there for all that stuff. You absolutely should be there to support your kids. But make sure that you're supporting them in this too. So my challenge to you parents is this last line here. I vow to lead my family in a study of God's Word at least once a day. Just get into the Bible. Read a chapter as a family. Start in the New Testament. Start in Matthew. Start learning about the life of Jesus. If you want, you can go get a daily devotional to read with your family. If you have questions, you don't know where to start, come talk to us. We want to help you in this. This is important. And our youth, they are important. So I want you to accept this challenge right now. Dads, I'm looking at you. Be the leader of your family. Take the challenge. God has put you in a place where you can be the leader of your house, just like it's intended to be. Take that challenge. And I know we've got some single moms out there. Guess what, moms? I respect that tremendously. I do. You can do this too. You can have an impact on your kid's life. So all I want you to do is, if you accept this challenge that you will be in God's Word with your family, I want you to just sign your name on this bulletin. And I know I've gone over a couple minutes, but this is important. This is really important. I want you to accept this challenge. Write your name on that line and say, you know what? I'm going to lead my family in a devotion of God's Word at least once a day. It doesn't have to be a big, long sermon or anything like that. Just talk about God's Word. Get them started somewhere. And the next thing I want you to do is take this bulletin with you. You don't have to keep all of it. If you don't like anything I said, just cut it all out, throw it away. You're not going to hurt my feelings. But keep the part where you're vowing to get into God's Word together. And I want you to put it somewhere in your house that you'll see every day as a reminder that you need to get into God's Word. Put it on your mirror in your bathroom. Put it on your refrigerator. Put it somewhere where you'll see it every day as a reminder that, hey, we haven't got into God's Word. Let's take some time away from everything else and get into God's Word. Will you do that for me? Will you be the leaders that this younger generation needs to look at for guidance? Because they'll be the first to tell you they're not perfect, but they're trying. They don't know it all. They don't have all the answers, but they want to learn about them. And it's going to take us. It's going to take some adults who are taking the initiative to say, you know what? I'm not going to let this generation fail. I want these kids, and I hope that your hope for these kids is that when they get up to heaven one day, they get to hear those beautiful words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And I hope you get to hear that too because of how you led your families. Don't look down on this generation. Build them up. And let's grow together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. I thank you for your word. And I thank you that we can come to you with this stuff and that we can try to make a difference in our culture. I thank you for our youth who have the desire and a passion to get to know you and to use your word to make a difference in the world around us. So God, as we leave here, I ask you would dismiss us with a sense of your presence and that we can walk out of here knowing that we can come to you with anything and that we can make a difference through you and that we can make an impact on the people around us. God, we love you, and it's in your name we pray. Amen. Guys, thank you so much for putting up with me. We'll see you next week.
Christ Community meets on Saturday at 5 p.m. and Sunday at 10:30 a.m. For more information, visit www.christcommunity.net or check out our Facebook page.